Okay.
Here you go.
It's okay.
each of you are welcome as we gather together on this fifth week after Pentecost to worship our Lord and our Savior. We will follow the order of morning praise on page 45. Our opening hymn is hymn 394, Blessed Are the Saints of God.
A messianic prophecy, as the prophets
were given insight into that which would come in the future, the shepherd would be struck, and the sheep scattered, but God would reserve a remnant of the faithful. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who is close to me, declares the Lord Almighty. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered, and I will turn my hand against the little ones. In the whole land, declares the Lord, two-thirds will be struck down and perish, yet one-third will be left in it. This third I will bring into the fire. I will refine them like silver and test them like gold. They will call on my name, and I will answer them. I will say, they are my people, and they will say, the Lord is our God. This is the word of our Lord. Our psalm for today is Psalm 22. We'll find it on page 71. We join to sing Psalm 22. Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia. Because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Alleluia. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel, and also the Word of God that we will meditate on in our sermon this morning, is recorded in Luke chapter 9, beginning at verse 18. Once when Jesus was praying in private, and his disciples were with him, he asked them, Who do the crowds say I am? They replied, Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others that one of the prophets of long ago has come back to life. But what about you? He asked. Who do you say I am? Peter answered, The Christ of God. Jesus strictly warned them not to tell this to anyone. And he said, The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests and teachers of the law, and he must be killed, and on the third day be raised to life. Then he said to them all, If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated and join to sing our next hymn, 453, Come Follow Me, the Savior's Soul.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. The Word of God for our meditation is the gospel lesson we have just heard. Please bow your heads with me. Spirit of God, be in my words, be in our listening, that your word might truly guide our lives. Amen. My dear friends, one of the challenges of fatherhood is I bet we could fill that sentence, that blank in with 1,000 different things. But what I'm going to use this morning is one of the challenges of fatherhood is teaching your children how to drive. Now, actually it was pretty much a breeze for me, except for one of our children. I'm not going to mention any names. A brilliant lad was he. the written test, any written test, he could pass hands down flying colors. But the practical common sense things, like, you know, you should slow down before taking a 90-degree corner and leaving a little distance between cars so that you're not smashing into the back of others and things like that. He just couldn't grasp those common sense things, and so he practiced over and over and over, road test after road test after road test. I like to use that picture of the road test, the driver's exam, as a metaphor to bring to you God's word today. We're going to be talking about God's driver's exam. As with every driving test, there is the written test, which tests your ability to understand the rules and the concepts of driving. And there is also then the road test that tests your ability to put those rules and concepts into practice when you're actually behind the wheel of a vehicle. So it is with God's driver's exam. Let's start with the written test. Jesus was called Rabbi. Rabbi means teacher. And like any good teacher, Jesus pauses for a moment to make sure that his students really got it. That they really had grasped what he was teaching them. It was test time. Now the Gospel of John fills us in a little bit on why Jesus chose this particular woman. It seems that there were crowds and crowds of people that had been following Jesus that now were not following him. They had come to the conclusion that Jesus was not the kind of Messiah that they were looking for. They were looking for someone who was going to solve their political problems, someone who would come and provide all that they needed for this life. And Jesus started talking about spiritual bread and that he was the bread of life and that they should be eating him. And they threw up their arms and they rolled their eyes and they walked off. He wasn't the one they were looking for. So what about the 12 who had been following him so faithfully? Would they also turn away from him, or would they be willing to walk the road that he was walking, the way that he chose to walk it? It was test time. I guess no one likes tests, but tests are necessary. In our spiritual lives, the crisis times of life are often the test times. But it's important for us to have testing times, even if there's not a crisis, for us to be carefully examining our lives. You know, am I on the right road? Am I traveling that road the way that Jesus would have me travel in a way that will bring honor and glory to him and that will bring good to me and those around me? it's good to stop and examine. Jesus begins with a preliminary question, one to kind of get his students' minds going the right direction. Who do the crowds say I am? Easy question. People had all kinds of opinions about Jesus, some absolutely amazing ones, in fact. They had very high opinions of him. And Jesus doesn't even comment on all their conjectures. He just gets right to the point. Jesus' written exam has one question. Doesn't need any others. In this one question is all that we need to travel the road of life. But you, who do you say I am? Peter, answering as he often did for all the rest of them, gave a very good answer. You are the Christ of God. They firmly believed that he was the Christ, the promised one, the Messiah, the one who had come as God had promised and undo the curse that sin had brought into this world. They were convinced. And there isn't a more important question for each of us to also be asked. As for you, who do you say Jesus is? Oh, ignore what everybody else is saying, and there remains all kinds of opinions today. There are countless people in this world for whom Jesus Christ is nothing more than something you shout out when you're exasperated. There are many moderns who look upon Jesus as one who is just a great teacher of loving ways. And there are the cults that have all kinds of strange ideas. All that doesn't matter. What about you? Who do you say he is? Well, you all know the answer. You learned it well in catechism class. True God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, who is our Lord. But does that answer come too quickly, too easily, without any reverence, any bending of the knee? Is it just an answer that you have learned and that you spout out? Kind of like the pastor who was having a devotion with some children, and they were playing a little guessing game. I'm small and have a long bushy tail, I love nuts, and I jump from tree to tree. Who am I? The little boy raised his hand, and he said, it sure sounds like a squirrel to me, but since we're in church, the answer's gotta be Jesus. Is that kind of, you just got the, you know, that's the answer. And, you know, it's important for us to have the right answer. But there's more. It's absolutely essential for us to have the right answer. But there's more. Just like there's a whole lot more to driving than having read through the official Wisconsin driver's manual. And so it is that God's driver's test also has the road test. Not just the written exam, you know the right answer, but can you put it to practice in your life? And Peter's good confession, Jesus shows him what it means, what he has just said, that he's the Christ. For Jesus, it meant the prophecy of Zechariah. The shepherd is struck and the sheep are scattered. It meant suffering and death and resurrection. Without the cross, there is no Christ. Jesus knew what this meant for him. And for those who would follow him, it also meant a cross. If anyone would come after me, he must take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for me will save it. Jesus is saying, Peter, I'm sure glad you know the right answer, but let's see if you know what it means to put that answer into practice in your daily lives. Contrary to popular opinion, Christianity is a whole lot more than knowing the right answers. To think that that's all there is to it is like thinking that the wedding is all there is to a marriage, or that reading a book on Mario Andretti is all there is to driving. How do you put it into practice, that truth? Yes, the right answer is Jesus, Son of God, my Savior. But what does that mean? You know, I could read in the driver's manual how to parallel park a car. Does that mean that I can actually do it without any scratches or dents? Get my car between those other cars? There's more to it. Jesus says, for you to confess me as the Christ on paper, in confession, means in very practical terms, deny yourself and daily take up your cross and follow me. What self do you deny? Deny that you exist? Do you deny yourself all the good things you want? Best foods? Do you deny... What does it mean to deny yourself? The self that Jesus is talking about denying, obviously, is that old sinful self, that very real part of us that gets us constantly into all kinds of trouble. Takes us down the wrong roads. That's the part that we deny. In other words, when we are faced with temptation, any temptation, let's say a temptation to live together before you're married, or to cheat on your taxes, and you've got it all rationalized. Everyone else is doing it, it's going to be good, it's economical, and you've got it all figured out, all the reasons. And then Jesus comes along and says, but as for you, who do you say I am? And we say, well, you're the Christ. And Jesus says, if I'm the Christ, then why aren't you following my will? Why aren't you going my way instead of your own way? You see, it's like putting on your blinker to go right and then turning left. You can't turn both ways at the same time. To follow Christ is to deny that sinful self. That sinful self says to us, boy, I'm just too tired to go to church today. I'm too busy to sit down and read my Bible. And Jesus comes along and says, as for you, who do you say I am? If you say that I am the Christ, the one who is worthy of all worship and honor and glory, then why aren't you giving it to me, no matter how tired you are? Either I am the Christ and you worship me, or I am not and your confession is nothing but a lot of hot air. Jesus asks us to deny ourselves daily, every single day. He is asking us that question. As for you, who do you say I am? It affects every word that we say, every direction we take in life, everything about us. Who is he? Christ. The fact is that living our lives only for ourselves is to deny him. As Jesus said, for whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will save it. There are two ways in this world. There's the way of the world, which focuses on wealth and possessions and popularity and beauty and all of those things. And there is Jesus' way, which is obedience, service, and kindness, and life with him, and with one another. And we have to choose. There's a fork in the road. One great man in the Bible spoke out very boldly at such a crisis time in life. And he said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's the direction we're going. The greatest challenge of fatherhood is not necessarily teaching our children how to drive, although that's part of it, isn't it? If you think about it, what does it mean to be a father? Isn't it to be a protector? And yes, there's a lot of danger out there. Our young people need to understand and respect that vehicle. It's a wonderful piece of equipment, and it's also an angel of death. And so they need to understand how important that is. But that's just one small part. There's many other places in life. If my father said it to me once, he said it to me 1,000 times. Son, be careful. Son, be careful. The greatest challenge of fatherhood, ultimately, is to pass the faith on to the next generation. Because only that will keep them safe, truly safe, for all of eternity. And yes, that means making sure that they are well grounded in the scriptures, so that they won't be led astray by every huckster that comes along. But it takes more than that. No child has learned properly how to drive by just reading the manual. It means being right there with them in life, day by day, sitting on the seat beside them. Slow down, speed up, watch that, be careful. It takes being with them, ultimately teaching them the most important rule of the road. Keep your eye on the road. And that road is Jesus. The way, the truth, and the life. Amen. And now the peace of God that passes our understanding shall keep your hearts and minds safe in Jesus our Savior. Let us join to sing, "We Praise You, O God."
Thank you.
sign the friendship register.
Thank you.
rise for our closing prayer, please. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving us our fathers, fathers who kept us safe, fathers who taught us the faith so that we might be safe with you for eternity. We ask, O Lord, that you would bless every family with fathers that are there to guide and protect, to guard, and to teach your ways. We ask, O Lord, that you bless every father in our congregation to the glory of your kingdom. We also come to you with a very special prayer of thanksgiving this morning, as Bob and Noelle of Wake this week celebrate 63 years of wedded bliss. From those early years as a young military couple, newlyweds, to today as they face the difficulties of old age, we ask, O Lord, that you bless their prayers, their every request to your glory and their good. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power, and grant that this week we never either fall into sin or run into any kind of danger. But in all that we do, direct us to what is right in your sight, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Father's Day, fathers. So you, there's a few, thank you. There's a few announcements that I will emphasize. VBS this week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. Mrs. Acker and Mr. Winkler have been very busy getting the school ready. There's a real cave. We're going spelunking this week, and it's going to be one lot of fun. A couple things on that. One is I'm missing some things that I need yet. Anyone happens to have a helmet with a light on, or at least the light you can wear on your head, I might need something like that. Or a bit of Christmas lights that's battery powered. Small set of Christmas battery powered Christmas lights. Anyone has something like that, let me know. So we need a couple props yet. Otherwise, we're ready to go on Monday. And that takes us to next week, is our church picnic. Because it's our church picnic, we're having service an hour earlier, so 10 o'clock service down at school. Later. Thank you. Later. And because of that also, there is not communion next week, there will be communion on the Thursday service. And I've been asked to just make a correction. Apparently it was put two different ways, two different places. If you have script that you wanted to order, it's kind of due now. It'll hold Jenny soon instead of next week. I noticed that there was a bunch of usher schedules. When I was gone a couple weeks ago, the usher schedules came out and they didn't have names on them. So there are some probably took the usher schedule and some didn't. We don't know who did, who didn't. So I kind of put some names on them. If you don't have an usher schedule, be sure to pick yours up. They're in the back this morning. Then two other things. I've been asked to announce that the basement has all been moved around and been waxed. And a few extra hands could be used to come and set everything back up downstairs. And so if you have a few moments after the service, if you could go down and help put the basement back together again. And then one other thing, I don't know if the whole congregation is aware, but we had a council meeting, well, that's been a long time ago. And we wanted to give a little gift to President Paul. He's the president of our district, has helped us in many ways over the years. Instrument in getting us our next pastor and everything. And so he was retiring from being district president. We sent him a little gift, and many other congregations did too. It looks like we might have given him enough to take a little cruise on the last one or something. So he put a little thank you. It's on the post in the back. You want to leave his appreciation to all of our good wishes and appreciation for all that he did for us. And he better take his good wife, Charlotte. She sacrificed an enormous lot, him being gone all the time as district president. I think that's all I have. Is there something more that needs to be announced that someone knows that I forgot? Have a lot of them, didn't it? Have a great weekend, everyone.